So how do we apply what we have seen in these videos and resources so far? What actions can we actually implement to develop learning environments that support students' basic psychological needs and support their autonomous motivation? In this video, we will be looking at general recommendations and strategies to do so. However, please do think of other ways to action this in your particular educational settings. So how can we look at our educational practice through the lens of the self-determination theory and consider our students' basic psychological needs? The following recommendations and tips are mainly based on these two papers. If you would like to read them, I'll leave the links in the description below. We now know that in order to promote autonomous motivation, we should develop a learning environment that supports students' perceived autonomy, competence, and relatedness. So let's start by seeing a few ways in which we can support their autonomy. The first recommendation refers to communication and is to avoid controlling language. By this, I mean to change phrases that denote mandatory instructions to phrases that denote choice, suggestions, and negotiations with the students. For instance, phrases like "you must do" or "you should do this or that" to obtain or avoid a consequence, for phrases suggesting what to do and providing the rationale for these actions so that students may choose to engage rather than feel forced to do so. Here, of course, the tone and nonverbal communication is also relevant. At first, this may seem like a non-relevant detail, but remember that the way in which engagement and action is initiated has important consequences for its maintenance in time. The way that students receive certain instructions and advice is important. No one really likes to have a bossy teacher. The second recommendation is to avoid and being cautious when providing tangible rewards. The main idea is that when tangible rewards are offered, it becomes hard for students to identify with and value the task or contents. This does not contribute to internalization and may even externalize the reasons to engage. The tangible rewards control students' behavior, so the recommendation is to favor verbal rewards, and in case you wish to provide tangible rewards, try to make this unexpected by students. The third recommendation is to provide options and to make students active participants of their learning process. What kind of options may you give students? Could these be options during your courses or placements? Perhaps negotiate which type of activities they would prefer, which contents or activities they and you think they should devote more time to? It's important to provide options, but try not to get too excited with so many options that could overwhelm students. Try to keep it simple. How about when it comes to assessment? Do students have a say when it comes to planning their workplace-based assessment moments? Or for written assessment, the use of learning management systems such as Blackboard or Canvas or other assessment software may offer the possibility for students to plan their assessment within an established time frame. Now, when it comes to curriculum development, how can we offer students the possibility to deepen in their areas of interest? Well, the core and options type of curriculum offers this possibility, where students have core subjects, but also disciplinary electives to choose from. As you can see, choices can go from small options to major curricular interventions. The fourth recommendation is to give value to activities and contents, especially to those that students might find less interesting. It is unrealistic to think that all activities and all courses will genuinely interest students. And so it is key to provide rationale and explain why these activities are important, why they matter, and why students should value them. Think of ways to stimulate their curiosity, providing practical examples and work-related problems that they will face as practitioners will help them value the uninteresting. The fifth recommendation is to encourage students to accept more responsibility for their learning and to become self-initiators. And this can be done in a variety of ways. Active learning is really important here, Students should not attend sessions to be passive receptors of information. They should learn actively and mobilizing the contents. Interactive and flipped lectures, small group and collaborative learning are just a few examples of this. Other ways of encouraging students to accept more responsibility for their learning are ending sessions with further questions to be discussed in the next session and allotting some good-to-know topics for self-study. Teachers do need to communicate these expectations of responsibility to the students clearly and early in the course. In workplace settings, make students responsible of their patients and of the solutions to their problems. Observation from educators is critical for a gradual and safe transference of responsibility. Regarding this, the concept of entrustable professional activities is becoming quite popular as a way to formally transfer responsibility to students in the workplace. If EPAS interests you, it would be a good idea to further research on this. For students interested in teaching or in research, it may be a good option to let them have some teaching responsibility or to participate in current research projects, and this will also make them feel more part of their professional community. Now, what other ways can you think of to support your students' perceived autonomy? Let's turn now to recommendations to support students' perceived competence. The first recommendation is to take the time and give importance to feedback, which we will see in much more detail later in this module. A feedback that is positive, constructive, timely, and informative. Establish as a dialogue in which both the learner and educator have active roles. It is really important here that feedback also focuses on reflection and self-assessment in order to support students' regulation and lifelong learning. Another important aspect in feedback, and this is especially relevant when students might not have performed at the desired level, is to remind them of past successes. What did they do to succeed compared to now? Help them identify their strengths and skills and how they might revert a negative situation. This should help to increase their competence perception. A second recommendation relevant to competence is providing structure and modeling the desired performances or standards. In this sense, and especially for clinical education, a vicarious learning experience is favorable. Seeing how someone else performs and to be shown how to do things certainly increases competence perception, especially when doing things for the first time. If we actually see someone else doing it, it kind of feels more possible, especially if it's done by someone at a similar level of training. And structure provided by teachers is also relevant. Students do need guide on what to do and what not to do, what is expected from them. Guidance on what is the standard to achieve. This should be explicit along with assessment criteria. So we now see the relevance that structure has and that is not necessarily a synonym of control. The third recommendation to support competence is to provide challenges. But these challenges have to be neither too easy nor too difficult.
Quite a dilemma.
It shouldn't be such a dilemma if we try to keep challenges at the level or slightly above the level of performance expected from the students. There will be no stimulus or engagement if challenges are constantly too easy, so a student's perceived competence will decrease. And same happens if challenges are constantly way above the level of students. To put it simple, we all like to perform well, and as we do so, we gradually seek for greater challenges. But when facing these greater challenges, what happens if things start going wrong, especially in the workplace? Well, here, the educator's way of intervening is key, for patient safety reasons as well, and to make students participant observers and not passive observers. The fourth recommendation is to try to involve your students in decisions where their input could be valuable. Asking for suggestions to optimize an ongoing process, for example, can help maximize a sense of empowerment, progress, and ownership. So now the question turns to you once again. What other ways can you think of to support your students' perceived competence? Let's see now a few recommendations on how to support students' perceived relatedness. And the first recommendation here is to create a safe environment for students. Build that teacher-student rapport and mutual respect, where they can feel confident enough to criticize others, including us, but may also be confident enough to be criticized. The emotional support and feeling cared and valued are also relevant aspects here. Let us not forget that health professional students are under a lot of stress, responsibilities, and demands. So we need to acknowledge and validate our students' emotions as well as their reactions. It is important to communicate that you care about students' well-being and not just their performance or productivity. The second recommendation is to support teamwork. Create instances where students may know you, professionally speaking, of course, where you may share experience. How did you cope with what they are going through now? Take the time to get to know your students. Also, instances where they can meet, work, and interact with their peers too. Try to support learning strategies through collaboration and discussion between them and other members of the healthcare team. This is a really important skill to learn, as they will have to work in teams in their clinical practice. And when problems arise, make sure to get full feedback from those involved. This helps you identify the biggest issues and obstacles, while strengthening connection and encouraging communication. Do emphasize that people's contributions in the team are unique and necessary. Do not let good work go unnoticed. And so the question turns back to you once again. What other ways can you think of to support your students' perceived relatedness? Now, if we take this to how we plan our lessons, we may think of what we could do at the planning phase, at the start of the lesson, and also during and at the end of the session. In the planning phase, it is important to take the student's perspective and ask yourselves, what will the students see when I present this activity or session? Will this be relevant to them? Will it stimulate their curiosity? This is crucial to vitalize their autonomous motivation. When starting your lesson, do not forget to explicitly provide rationale for engagement. Students do need to know why this should be important for them. And during and at the end of the session, it's important to seek and to give constructive feedback and avoid external pressure and controlling language. So now, lots of the recommendations we have spoken about here go from minor interventions to major ones. But keep in mind that minor and constant reinforcements of their basic psychological needs can make a big difference for your students' motivation. In this series of videos, we have seen that there are different quality types of motivation that lead to different educational outcomes. We have also seen why, in our educational practice, we should support students' basic psychological needs to develop learning environments that support students' autonomous motivation, and that we should not attempt to control student behavior. Rather, we should create the conditions for them to self-motivate. So we may think now of motivation as the art of getting people to do what you want to do because they want to do it.